there have been men, many of them, who claim to be a new Messiah. And tonight we're going to meet three of them, including one in the faraway Philippines who has amassed a flock, he says, numbers in the millions. Poor people who give what little they have to the man they believe is the second coming of Jesus.
But what if the second coming is here, now? There are a number of would-be messiahs who claim exactly that, and few are more physically convincing than a former Russian traffic cop named Sergei Torov. Meanwhile, in London, David Shaler says he is the true Lord of Lords.
This behind me is supposed to be the tomb of Christ. Well, I'm Christ, I'm not in the tomb, I'm not dead yet.
But that is not a sentiment shared by Pastor Apollo Quibeloy, the most successful of the world's self-labeled saviors.
The official coming of the Son of God was in April 13, 2005.
He was an obscure evangelist from the rural Philippines until 2005, when he announced that God had appointed him Christ on earth.
All of us in America have lived with the prospect of another terrorist attack, and today top counterterrorism officials appeared before Congress with a warning. They said the danger is as grave as it has been since September 11th, 9 years ago. And they said Al-Qaeda has new ways of recruiting people inside this country.
Today's top story, another act of defiance by North Korea's communist regime. A new threat of a possible satellite and missile launch have been announced. It comes despite a strong warning from the U.S. against taking these kinds of measures.
Last week's red terror alert is just a trial run for a massive stage terror attack.
Just a month ago, they were briefing here that while there were attacks being carried out in Northern Ireland, they had no evidence to suggest that these dissident Republicans were preparing to target mainland Britain.
Oh, I wrote these things down exactly as I saw them. He spoke with great eloquence and charisma. He was soothing and promised answers to all current issues. This man was smooth and extremely convincing, able to solve nearly all problems. This man's speeches and directions for the whole world had to do with new times upon us as human beings, new directives for global peace. He spoke of world order and the need to give up current citizenship for world citizenship. I will never forget this individual's face. His face was almost supernatural in appearance. He was almost too perfect.
Men came to us that we were to find out were from the government.
Niște oameni au venit la noi și după aia am aflat mai târziu că erau din partea guvernului.
They were from the CIA and the FBI. We had developed the first identification device, and it was completed in the early 70s. They came back to us and they said, we want something better than that. And so we said, if you have enough money, we can develop anything. I was not alone there. There were 100 people involved in the project. Some were from General Electric, some from Motorola, some were from the Bell Laboratories, some were from the Boston Medical Center, and some were from Stanford University. When it was completed, it was the size of 1/4 of a grain of rice. Again, I want to say that I was not a Christian and there were no Christians there. They said they wanted this to have a power source and be able to emit a signal. And they told us they wanted us to use lithium as a battery source. I designed into this microchip a little charging circuit that would charge that battery. This sounds like a lot of technical things coming together, but if you'll bear with me 1 minute, you'll see what God has laid out about this microchip. I needed a temperature change, a change in temperature, to cause current to flow through that little charging circuit that would charge the battery. We began to investigate and find out where in the body does the temperature change the most rapidly. It was determined that there were two places in the body that were ideal for the microchip. One was just below the hairline on the forehead. Every mother checks their child's temperature right here. The other place was the hand, the right hand preferred, because most people are right-handed. The hand seemed a good place. Nobody wanted it here. You're seeing it now on some of the Discovery Channel presentations. There are people who have received it already. It is real. But this is the device that puts the microchip in. This is called an incisor.
A computer chip that could be implanted under your skin so doctors can quickly access your medical records. The FDA just gave a Florida company the go-ahead to do it. You might recall about 2 years ago, a family was implanted with a Verichip right here on the Today Show. Scott Silverman is the chairman and CEO of Applied Digital Solutions, the maker of the Verichip. Scott, good morning to you. Thanks for joining us.
Good morning, Lester.
Explain to me briefly what the Verichip is and what it is supposed to do.
Verichip is a tiny miniaturized RFID or radio frequency identification microchip. It gets injected, just like getting a shot of penicillin or any medicine that you would get in a doctor's office. Thanks to the FDA and their diligent work over the last 2 years, we now have the clearance to go to market with both the chip and the scanner. It'll have my driver's license information, it'll have medical information, it'll have financial information, and it'll have security information for ingress and egress into facilities.
I knew that research had not been done on the effects of lithium in the body. So I called a doctor at the Boston Medical Center who had been on the project. I said, what would happen if the microchip gets shattered or broken and the lithium is in the body? He said, you would get a sore. He said you would get a sore like a boil, or it would not heal.
After a few moments, I turned back, and there was the Lord Jesus Christ standing behind me. I don't know how he got in that room, because it was just a small holding cell, and the doors behind us were shut. And then all of a sudden, he looked me in the eyes. He looked at me very, very sternly. It wasn't like a reproof or a conviction, but it was more of just him looking and peering into my life. And this presence that he stood in was so powerful, so awesome, so anointed, so terrible, so to speak. Like the scriptures say, he's terrible in his presence. Terrible in the sense that you knew that there's no power on earth that could challenge him. And when he looked through me, he knew everything about me. He knew every nook and cranny. And about a few moments after realizing this, realizing my own depravity, he spoke to me and he looked sternly into my eyes and he said, "Fear not, my son, for death will never hold you." This was unusual to me. And then instantly it was like a kind of a courage flooded through me. I wish I could tell you that I got very bold and preached a great sermon and got everybody saved, but I didn't. It was just courage to go through what was before me. When this man cut my head off, as soon as the very instant I saw the sword coming down and it touched my neck, the moment that the blade touched my neck, I was gone. I felt no death whatsoever. And all of a sudden, I was up, it wasn't a ceiling as this high, but it was quite high. And I was standing there and again holding a person's hand, and I was looking down upon the scene. And it was very grotesque, and I don't know why I was shown it this way, but I'm going to tell you exactly what I saw from the beginning to the end. My head was cut off, and I was bleeding profusely. It was very, very strange. And even though this hand was holding me, I didn't know who it was. I was actually more interested in seeing me dead there than the fact that I was actually delivered from the death. And I looked up, and it was the Lord again, the Lord Jesus Christ. Folks, it doesn't matter what you go through here. It doesn't matter what trial you're experiencing. And I don't know why the Lord doesn't choose to show everybody himself. I don't know. I have no idea why he showed me this. I was a sinner. I was not even interested in following him. I didn't ask for this. I'm not worthy of receiving anything where he showed himself to me. And I can tell you that whatever trial you go through, even if it's being brought to a point where you have to lay down your life, it is worth it. Because of what I saw in my Savior. At this point now, it went from a stern, powerful, all-knowing God to a God who was holding my hand that gave me the understanding that now I was his son, I was his brother, I was his brethren, that he was not ashamed to call me his brethren. We'll be right back.